Hello, it's time again for the Queensland Storyteller. I'm Kim Dodsworth. Now, regular listeners will be familiar with the Miles family of Lancashire, England, and their rascally but endearing young daughter, our Maudie. Set immediately post-World War II, the family's story continues to go from strength to strength, always with good humour and lots of infectious laughter. The author is Maureen Edwards of Melbourne. Thanks, Maureen, for another great story. It was definite. I had piano fingers. I suppose it's true. Even though I'm just a kid, my hands are long and skinny and I have double-jointed thumbs. To my mum, all this was suddenly meaningful. She hatched a plan. Now that the war was well and truly over, she'd saved enough to buy me a piano. With my fingers, I stood more than a fair chance of becoming famous. And famous meant we'd be able to move to new and exciting places. She seemed to have forgotten that she usually told me that I was tone deaf and had no ear for music. Maudie Miles, will you stop that hollering? You sound worse than next door's tomcat. This was now a minor point in the scheme of things. Your fingers will prove me wrong, Maudie love. Just you wait and see. Mum paid some older kids to wheel the piano down our cobble street through the front door and into the parlour. She'd bought it from Chattering Hannah, who lives six doors up. £1, 5 shillings and 6 pence. Hannah said take it before her brother Henry chopped it up for firewood. Henry had problems. Chattering Hannah was a troubled soul too, but her heart was in the right place. She was needed in the village. For starters, she was a dab hand at laying people out. She had special pennies to put on their eyes. She could make the ugliest corpse look peaceful, could Hannah. It was an art. She was a second to none at delivering babies, too. Even though she madly recited poetry while she tended women through their labour, she knew what were what and got on with the job. She was dirt cheap, too. If you had nothing in your purse, she'd settle for a drop of gin. Sometimes her brother Henry slapped her. You could walk past the house and hear all the dogs going bonkers and Hannah screaming, "Someone fetch the bobby!" No one ever did, though. But then, Henry had been shell-shocked in the war, and he had a piece of shrapnel lodged. No one knew where it was lodged, and he refused to tell. My mum and her best friend Mab said they knew, but they weren't telling either. Our piano was disappointing. It wasn't all shiny and polished. It was covered in scratches and daubs of blue and yellow paint, and not all the notes played. Mum was going to have it fixed, though. It would be as good as new when Blind Billy, the piano tuner, next visited the village. One thing she hadn't reckoned with, the piano was haunted. Sometimes it would play a note all on its own, sometimes in the middle of the night. Bing, bing, bing. Is that you, our Maudie? Get yourself back to bed this instant. I am in bed, Mum. Ping, ping, ping. I can't fathom it, said Mum. It's likely a spirit, said my sister Moira, and knowing our dad was besotted with a certain pianist, it's the ghost of Eileen Joyce come to visit our dad. Don't be such a fathead, Moira, said Mum. Eileen Joyce isn't dead yet. It took our dad to work it all out. You bought yourself a heap of trouble, Nancy Miles. There's a nest of mice in there. It's bloody teeming with them. Mum and Moira jumped up on the settee, held their skirts high and screamed their heads off. That was the end of my piano fingers and my musical career. The piano was wheeled back up the street, back to Chattering Hannah's house quick sharp. Mum didn't get her money back either. Henry had spent it all on the booze. Mum didn't have the heart to complain. Anyway, Hannah promised, when the time came, she would lay us all out free to make up for it. After the eviction, one mouse got left behind. It kept making an appearance in the kitchen. Immediately, Moira and Mum screamed and ran around holding up their skirts. Bino, my dog, thought it was a good game. He played nipping Mum and Moira on the ankles. That made them scream more. Our resident mouse was christened Houdini on account of his ability to escape death. He ate the cheese out of all the mouse traps. Mum was going spare. Mice were vermin. We'd all end up with a bubonic plague for sure, or we'd get consumption. You got that from mice droppings. Every day we inspected the bread for little black droppings. There was no cure, not unless we all went to live in the mountains in Switzerland and drank fresh goat's milk. That was out of the question, so we'd all sit around the fire in the kitchen and take it in turns to cough up frothy red blood into kidney-shaped dishes. And then we'd all die one by one. I don't know what I'll do if I'm last to die. If Chattering Hannah came to lay the others out, I'd have no one to talk to until my last cough. "I'll fix that bugger of a mouse before it fixes us," said Mum one day when Dad was out. "I know it's in the kitchen, waiting to kill us." She shuddered. "And it'll be breeding. Before long we'll be overrun. It'll take a woman to fix this. You watch. Quick, Morty, bring all the cushions you can find. Our Moira, fetch all the doormats and draught stoppers. Hurry up now, don't just stand there gaping." Cushions and mats and draught stoppers were placed under all the gaps in the kitchen doors. She closed and fastened all the windows. Then with a flourish, she opened the door of the gas oven. "Abracadabra," she said. "What now?" said Moira. "This," said Mum. She turned the gas oven on full. She didn't light it. "You watch it shift now, I'm gassing it." "Shouldn't the mouse have its head in the oven?" said Moira. "By rights, love, but the gas should reach it. Let's get out of here. We'll give it half an hour." We all trooped through the house and out of the front door. While Houdini committed involuntary suicide, we were going to visit Mum's friend Mabs and have a cuppa. Just to be on the safe side, Mum walked around and pinned a note on the kitchen door for Dad. "Dear Eddie, do not light a fag. I'm gassing the mouse." "All's well that ends well," said Mum with a smile. "Let's get that brew cracking, Mabs. We have something to celebrate." You could hear our dad roar from over at Mab's house. We all went flying back to see what had happened. "What's all that noise about?" said Mum. "Have you found the body already? I thought it'd take longer." "Hell's bloody bells, Nancy," shouted Dad. "What next?" "I was just about to light up me woodbine when I smelt it. Your note was blown away down the yard. You could have blasted the whole bloody street to kingdom come." "It wouldn't have been much of a loss, would it?" said Mum. "The rest of the world wouldn't blink. It was downright dangerous. If that gas meter hadn't run out of money, I might be sitting on God's right hand by now." "Darn it," said Mum. "I forgot to put a penny in. I suppose it's still alive." "It wasn't a bloody clever thing to go and do." "It's the bloody countryside, isn't it? We never had plagues of mice where I come from. It's you who insists on living in such a godforsaken place. And where do you want to live now, Mrs. Iron Mighty? Somewhere civilized would be a good start. Back to town. I want to give Moira and Morty a good start in life." "Have some sense, woman. There's nowt wrong with village life. You started all this nonsense with that piano. As if our Morty could be a musician. Have you heard her sing? She sounds like a bloody foghorn." "She has piano fingers, though. Have a look at them." "I give in," Dad groaned. "I'll tell you what. They're asking for folk to go and work in Australia. I'm going to apply right now. We'll see how that suits you." He grabbed his old checked cap, shoves his teeth in. Then he's off, slamming the back door behind him. "Hell's bells," said Mab. "Out of the frying pan. There's nothing but dust, kangaroos and boomerangs in Australia. Think of something quick, Nancy, before he comes back." "Hey," said Mum. "You know, Eddie, he's bluffing. We're not going anywhere. But I'd best be prepared. Look here, Morty. Your legs are growing that long. I'll buy you some tap shoes. You'll make one hell of a dancer." "She'll be Lancashire's answer to Shirley Temple," said Mabs. I was saved by a mouse. Right then, Houdini decided to make a run for it. Mum and Mabs, screaming blue murder, ran for it too. Well, that was Of Mice and Pianos by Maureen Edwards of Melbourne. I'm Kim Dodsworth. I hope you'll join us again this time next week for another short story of quality.